Thank you very much for having me. Today I'm presenting a paper which I wrote jointly with Don Farmer, who's in the room here. And the title is The Systemic Implications of the Bill in Design. The failure of the investment bank Lehman Brothers was a very defining event in the last financial crisis, almost bringing the financial system as well as the real economy on its knees. And the governments at the time were forced to choose between the very unattractive options of either bailing out a bank or having to fail it in a manner that could be very disorderly and have negative consequences for financial stability. And any of the existing bankruptcy procedures were basically not adequate for dealing with the failure of large, systemically important and complex banks. So a Squam Lake report came out that offered advice on how to reform the financial system. And one of the main recommendations was that the power should have the ability to orderly resolve large systemically important banks. And this recommendation has both been adopted in the European Union under the Bank Recovery and Resolution Directive, and also in the United States under the orderly liquidation provision of the Dodd-Frank Act. Now, bail-in has been widely hailed as the new way of dealing with bank failures, the primary tool that should allow these complex banks to be resolved. And it would have many benefits. For example, it could help to reduce the too-big-to-fail problem by basically letting the bank investors shoulder the losses rather than the taxpayers, which would help to address moral hazard, while hopefully being able to resolve that without causing too large contagion. Now, for those of you who don't know what bail-in is, let me give a short explanation here with this graph. So basically, other than contingent convertibles, bail-in is a statutory power, so that statutory power by the resolution authority that allows you to recapitalize a bank who is almost insolvent by basically writing down the notional of the holdings of liability holders and potentially compensating those who are affected with a new claim in the bank's equity. So you basically write down liabilities to create more equity, and that helps to recapitalize the bank. So that's the bail-in in a nutshell. Efficiency of bail-in to actually conserve financial stability in plausible crisis scenarios still remains an open question today. While small systemically important banks have sometimes been bailed in without causing large contagion, the bail-in in times of system-wide distress and bailing in large systemically important banks still has not been done. And it's not clear that it could be done without causing large contagion. And there are many leading thinkers who are quite skeptical that, in fact, it could be done. For example, Ben Bernanke notes that controversies still remain today over how effective even a Title II resolution would be in the context of a financial crisis. And Charles Goodhart argues that the bail-in approach may indeed be much superior to bailouts in the case of idiosyncratic bank failure, but in many other cases, the bail-in process may entail important risks. So, as we stand here today, the question of how the bail-in design might modify financial stability for better or for worse continues to be unanswered. So in the paper, we comprehensively investigate what the systemic impacts are of the way that the bail-in mechanism is designed. And importantly, we take into consideration the financial system as a whole. And we do that basically by extending the multi-layered network model that I actually developed, or started to develop while I was a PhD intern at the Bank of England in the team of Alex Brazier. So that's the start of my PhD. And importantly, this model captures five prevailing contagion mechanisms that could occur prior to or following bail-ins, and I will touch upon that later. Now, if I had to summarize the result of the paper in one line, it is that financial stability really hinges on the bail-in design. So how you design it really matters. And specifically, we look at six bail-in design parameters. When do you let a bank fail? To what extent do you recapitalize it? How much do you compensate those who are affected by the bail-in? So these are the first three. And then what debt do you include and not include in the bail-in? How much bail-inable debt should banks always hold? So what are these requirements levels? And how clear is it for investors in bail-inable debt what parameters a resolution authority would apply in a prospective bail-in? And that's really important, because if you don't know those, you can't basically properly price bail-inable debt, and so you can't price risk. And that can give rise to large instabilities, especially in system-wide crises. So in the remainder of this presentation, I'll briefly touch upon the literature review, the data, and the model. I won't actually show many of the formulas, so I refer to the paper for that, but I'll explain the basic idea of the bail-in design. And I will focus my efforts on the results and the policy discussion around those results, and then I'll conclude. So our contribution adds to a nascent literature on the systemic implications of the bail-in. And for example, Klimek and Husser have looked at whether bail-in can be done without undermining financial stability. But what these two papers have in common is that they neither include multiple contagion mechanisms nor non-banks, and they take the bail-in design as is, without allowing for different bail-in designs. So they only basically focus on exposure loss contagion in the banking system with one bail-in design. So we are, as far as we are aware, the first to investigate the financial stability consequences of the bail-in design in a networked financial system. So what data do we use to sort of calibrate this stress test? We basically use S&P Global Market Intelligence, ECB Statistical Warehouse, and the European Banking Authority 2018 stress test results. And this allows us to do three things. First, it allows us to initialize the balance sheets of European banks and non-banks, to decompose their liabilities in seniority classes, and we can infer the maturity profile of bail-inable debt. What we don't exactly know is the cross-holdings of bail-inable debt. So based on this balance sheet information and the decomposition in liability class, we can use very standard reconstruction techniques in the literature to reconstruct that. And potentially going forward, I'll be collaborating with people who actually have this data, so then we can do that in a more precise way. So I will now explain the basic idea of the bail-in design and the way we model it, focusing on first the primary bail-in design and then the secondary bail-in design. So the first parameter is, when do you let a bank fail? And the key condition that determines that is whether a bank is deemed failing or likely to fail, which is, for example, the case if the bank is nearly insolvent or nearly illiquid. And we basically model it as the risk-weighted capital ratio of a bank falls below a threshold or the bank becomes insolvent. So again, I will not show the formulas. Now, the next thing that must... So once it is determined that a bank should be bail-in, there are two phases of the bail-in. The first phase is to absorb any losses that, for example, have not yet been recognized. And then the next phase is to recapitalize the bank to a desired target. And always when you impose haircuts to basically affect these write-downs of liabilities, the rule is that you do that in accordance with the insolvency hierarchy in the normal insolvency law and proportional within each priority class. Now, what are the sort of guidelines that regulators set out for how much a bank should be recapitalized? Well, it should be recapitalized by a sufficient amount such that the short-term viability of this bank is restored. And this is said to be so if it complies with the conditions for authorization. So, for example, it must comply with the minimum capital requirements, and it sustains or regains market confidence. And this means that it may be further capitalized in line with its peers or to also meet its capital buffers. And so we basically, in the results section, investigate how varying the recapitalization target affects financial stability. Now, once some creditors have received haircuts, the question is how do you compensate them? And the debt-to-equity conversion rate basically determines how many shares a creditor in priority class K of the build-in bank receives per unit of haircuts applied to his principal amount of buildable claim. And the regulation basically sets out two key principles that the regulator or the resolution authority should adhere to when determining how to set these conversion rates. The first condition is that no creditor may be worse off in bail-in than in a hypothetical liquidation. But note, by the way, this is a really problematic condition from the perspective of the regulator, because you all of a sudden have to assess what the liquidation cost would be, let's say, of if Lehman Brothers would fail. That's not at all easy. And it's also problematic because creditors can basically sue the resolution authority if they believe they are, in fact, worse off. And the second condition is that the preservation of the normal hierarchy of claims in the insolvency procedure should be adhered to. And in my paper, and I won't go into details here, I basically mathematically derive, given these two principles, what is the scope of conversion rates that the regulator can choose while maintaining sort of adherence to these principles. And broadly speaking, the regulator can either set what we call fair, or on the other edge case, unfair conversion rates. So fair conversion rate is where you sort of compensate creditors more or less equally, whereas in the unfair case, you compensate some more than others. Specifically, you compensate the more senior more than others, the least the more junior. And we investigate again whether the choice of unfair is good or bad for financial stability. And I'll come to that in the results section. So I now explain to you the three components of the primary bail-in design. When do you let the bank fail? What is the recapitalization target? And what is the debt-to-equity conversion rate? Now, the secondary bail-in design deals more with the structural parameters that that sort of shape the system. And the first of these parameters is the loss absorption requirements. So the bail-in tool can really only be effective if the banks have sufficient loss absorption capacity. Otherwise, if the banks don't have enough debt that can be subject to the bail-in tool, actually the loss may not be fully absorbed, or you may not be able to fully recapitalize the bank. And that's obviously problematic, because that means that maybe you need to complement the bail-in with a bail-out, and then the taxpayer anyway suffers losses. And so there are two main requirements that apply to European banks. The first is TLAC, so that's the minimum total loss absorption capacity. That applies to every globally systemically important bank. And there's also the minimum requirement for own funds and eligible liabilities, MREL, and this applies to each bank in the European Union. And it basically, in the paper, I give the formulas for exactly what this minimum is. And we, in the results section, investigate how changing this minimum may affect financial stability. Now, there are two key rules that determine whether debt can count towards the loss absorption requirements. The first is that the time to maturity of that debt should have a maturity of at least 1 year. And for G-SIBs, the rule is that the build of debt cannot be cross-held by other G-SIBs. And the hope is to sort of get rid of contagion between G-SIBs. But obviously, that doesn't mean that contagion is gone, right? Others that hold the buildable debt, other banks or non-banks, if they suffer the losses, they may feed it back onto the banking system or onto the G-SIBs anyway. The second more structural parameter is what debt do you include in bail-in in the first place? And there are some liabilities that are always excluded. These are covered deposits, liabilities to institutions with a time to maturity less than 7 days, and secured liabilities up to their collateral value. And so note that while debt with a time to maturity greater than 1 year counts towards the loss absorption requirements, still debt with a time to maturity between 7 days and 1 year is in principle subject to the bail-in, and that's quite a vulnerable debt, and I'll come back to that. And so in addition to the fixed exclusions, the regulator may also apply ad hoc exclusions, for example, if it thinks that including these debts can lead to contagion, or actually another reason is that it's politically not feasible. With these exclusions in the model, the stack of bailable debt of a bank is basically given by the three layers of capital, Z1 capital, AT1 capital, T2 capital, and then there is more senior debt in priority class K4 and K5, which in our model is the interbank claims and other liabilities. And I've been advised by the IMF and others that I should also really include the deposits above the covered deposit scheme, because these are also very runnable and they are actually part of the bailable debt pile. So I'll update that. So then you get that the total bailable debt of a bank is the sum of the bailable debt in each priority class K, and the debt in each priority class K is basically the sum of contracts to different counterparties J in the financial system and with different maturities M. So here I give a little overview of how the debt composition of the banks that participated in the 2018 EBA stress test based on our estimation. And what should really strike you is that banks had relatively little debt in priority classes, in the first three priority classes, and even in the fourth. And then they have a lot of more senior debt, so a lot of debt in priority class K5 and a lot of deposits. So then the final more structural parameter is, do you as an investor in bailable debt know when a bank will be bailed in, what the recapitalization target is, and what the debt to equity conversion rates are? And actually there's one more parameter that was also pointed out that is an uncertainty, which is what are the ad hoc exclusions? Because if you don't know that as an investor, you can't price bailable debt and loss risk, as I explained. So I now explained to you the key components of the bail-in design. And in the results section, we will vary these ingredients to see how that impacts systemic risk. But first, I'll explain how we model multiple contagion mechanisms in the financial system. So we model the five prevailing contagion mechanisms in the EU: exposure loss contagion, overlapping portfolio contagion, funding contagion, bailable debt revaluations, and non-rollovers of bailable debt. So the joint modeling of the first three components are basically based on the paper that I developed at the Bank of England. And the latter two components are basically developed in this paper. And I won't really go into details here because of lack of time. But the key idea is that bailable debt can be valued in a very standard way, sort of as the current value is the future, the discounted value of future cash flows. And obviously, your return as an investor is the full notional if no bail-in takes place, and the haircutted notional plus the equity claim if a bail-in takes place. And basically, we consider the possibility of bailable debt collapses. That is to say, if creditors see that the bailable debt very sharply revalues, they may want to pull back their exposure to this debt, which has a high valued risk and a high expected loss. Or if they can't price bailable debt, they may just use a very coarse rule to pull back their exposure. So these are really sort of three plausible scenarios, as you do in a stress test, for why creditors may decide not to roll over bailable debt. So in this picture, we illustrate how all these contagion mechanisms interact. And importantly, as also Alan pointed out, how you can have these feedback loops in a complex financial system. So here we show that, let's say, a bail-in takes place with the light bulb. And first of all, that can lead to exposure losses because the creditors are affected. But that can actually set in motion a whole line of further contagion mechanisms. For example, those who suffer exposure losses may see that their own bailable debt is revalued because their probability of default basically goes up. And this may cause their creditors to decide to, for example, halt the rollover of bailable debt. But also, if a creditor of a bail-in bank suffers exposure losses, it may, as Rama pointed out, sort of hit its constraints. It may exceed its minimum capital requirements, and it may be forced to delever, which is sort of individually rational, but actually destabilizing from the perspective of the system as a whole. And to delever, the bank may, for example, liquidate securities, in which case you can get sort of fire sale effects, or it may pull back funding to others. And all these things, again, can feed back. You know, if you fire sale, that can lead to further revaluation of bail-in, and so on and so forth, and that can lead to more bail-ins. So importantly, we, just to stress, because this didn't always come across, we capture both the effects that could occur after a bail-in, but also the effects that could be in the run-up of a bail-in. So importantly, if there are some adverse stress scenario that causes the system to be in distress, prior to a bail-in taking place, creditors can already run. And this is important, as we will see in the results section. So I'll now move on to the results. And before I dive into the details, let me explain how we set up the examination of our results. So basically what we want to do is to understand the stability impact of the primary and the bail-in and the secondary bail-in design. And we also want to understand what the role is of each contagion mechanisms in enlarging the systemic implications of the bail-in design, so enlarging the systemic footprint. We don't focus on the last one in this presentation because of the limited time. I would want to stress, and this is similar to what Rama just said, that our results are really qualitatively robust. We did a lot of sensitivity analysis. But of course, to get more accurate quantitative outcomes, you would need to better calibrate market impact. Of course, you need to better know cross holdings and so on. So there's, you know, some work to do, but I think the qualitative insight is already really valuable. So to facilitate the cross comparisons across results, we use standard axes. So we look at on the y-axis always at the contagious asset losses, and we look at two cases in which a bail-in can take place. A bank may fail due to idiosyncratic reasons, so that's always the left plot, and a bail-in can take place in a system-wide crisis. And we want to show both results because maybe the bail-in design always works in an idiosyncratic bank failure, but never works in a system-wide crisis. So we want to investigate whether there's a difference. And we basically define a set of what we call good and bad parameters, or in other words, stability-enhancing or instability-enhancing parameters, which allows us to have a baseline from which we can do sensitivity analysis. And it basically allows us to investigate the stability impact of either extreme but still plausible set of parameters that a regulator could pick. And I really want to stress that we don't prescribe to always choose good parameters and never choose bad. We just want to basically qualitatively show the direction of how the bail-in design impacts stability. So what are the good primary parameters? That's basically an early recapitalization. So when a bank breaches its minimum capital requirements, a strong recapitalization, so to not only the minimum requirements, but to at least also the buffer standards that the bank faces, and fair conversion rates. Whereas bad primary parameters is like when you bail in a bank late, when it's already insolvent or close to insolvency, a weak recapitalization, so you just recapitalize the bank enough to meet its minimum capital requirements, and unfair conversion rates. And for the secondary parameters, what the good parameters are basically that you exclude debt from bail-in with a time to maturity less than 1 year. So this is in line with the TLAC and MREL requirements. Note that that's currently not the case. Currently only debt with time to maturity less than 7 days is excluded. You increase, not necessarily double, that's just for illustrative purposes, but you increase the loss absorption requirements, especially when you exclude some of that short-term debt to make up for the decrease of the pile of debt that you have as a consequence. And certainty in the bail-in design. Whereas the status quo is less good. Basically, you only exclude debt with a time to maturity less than 7 days. You stick to the current loss absorption requirements, and you leave huge uncertainty in the way a bank would be bail-in if it happens to be so. So focusing on the stability impact of the primary bail-in design first. Yes. So this is really the overarching plot that shows that the bill in primary bill in design really matters. So if you choose stability enhancing parameters, your system can be almost contagion free if you let the largest X European banks idiosyncratically fail, and you can sort of at least limit contagion in the system-wide crisis. Whereas if you choose the bad parameters, you really exacerbate contagion in both cases. Now the question is, okay, this is a joint impact of choosing good or bad parameter, but how does each parameter matter? And I will disentangle that now. So the first one is the failure threshold. So what we show here is that if you bail in a bank too late, so the top line, the blue line, is close to insolvency, you get a lot more contagion than you would have if you bail in a bank in time. So the lowest line actually shows the case where you bail in a bank to when it breaches its minimum capital requirements and its Pillar 2 capital requirements. Now, it's not clear that the regulatory failure threshold is in the region of stability, especially in the US. So the US Fed staff expresses that the resolution authority in the US model is slow in the sense that it will shut down and resolve a firm once its book equity capital is exhausted. So it basically chooses for the late bail-in when it's insolvent, and we show that that's not a good idea. And in the EU, regulators express that they, at least legally, will stick to the minimum authorization conditions when they bail in a bank, which is the good parameter, but it's not clear that that will actually happen because regulators are often slow to intervene. So while sort of officially they need to intervene at the minimum capital requirements, supervisors may act too late. And that's a worry that, for example, Charles Goodhart and Avo Goulis have. So now focusing on the second primary parameter, the recapitalization target. So what we show here is that the degree to which you recapitalize a bank really matters for financial stability. If you recapitalize a bank stronger to also include the buffer and not just as a top line, the minimum requirements, you can really bring down contagion in system-wide crisis, and you can even eliminate contagion in the case of either syncretic bank failure. And the intuition is basically that banks that are more strongly recapitalized are less likely to act in destabilizing ways. Their own remaining bailable debt is less likely to further revalue. They're less likely to experience funding outflows. So it's really beneficial. Now, it's not evident, again, that the recapitalization target is in the regime of stability, because basically, the regulator, as I explained, set out three ways that they could do it. The minimum capital requirements I already showed is very destabilizing from the perspective of financial stability. In times of crisis, the peers of a bank probably have depressed capital ratios too, so that's also not a strong enough recapitalization. And recapitalization to also meet the bank's regulatory buffers is good, but regulators may be hesitant to do that because recapitalization above the minimum requirements may leave the regulators prone to lawsuits for infringing upon property rights. And just noting, with every bail-in that has been done, all the creditors have sued. So it's really a big risk. Now I will focus on, so the last parameter is the debt to equity conversion rate. And basically what we show is that most of the time allocating the losses more fairly is better from the financial perspective of financial stability than allocating losses unfairly. And interestingly, obviously, if you do not compensate creditors, which is the zero conversion rate, that corresponds to pure write-downs, you're in the worst scenario. And actually, it is expressed that creditors may actually have to wait for months before they know, what debt to equity ratio return they get before they get their equity claim back. So in the short run, actually, creditors face a pure exposure loss. That's the worst case. So this is another reason that advocates for executing a bank bail-in quickly, because if you wait for a long time before you sort of finalize the return of equity, you leave the creditors in the meanwhile in paralysis, and this also adds to uncertainty. So I will now conclude, the impact of the secondary bail-in design will be left for the discussion. So basically, I want to end this presentation by returning to the words of Ben Bernanke that I used in the beginning of this presentation, which is, and he writes, have we ended bailouts? We cannot guarantee that a future administration fearful of the economic consequence of a building financial crisis will not authorize a financial bailout. But the best way to reduce the odds of that happening is to have in place a set of procedures to deal with failing financial firms that those responsible for preserving financial stability expect to be effective. So the key thing is that moral hazard is only reduced if bail-ins are a credible alternative to bailout. And basically, our paper showed that the credibility of the bail-in critically depends on the bail-in design, and it is not obvious that the current bail-in design is effective. But there's also an optimistic message, especially when you also allow for the secondary parameters to be well-tuned, which is we actually show that a bank bail-ins may successfully be carried out even in system-wide crisis if you design the bail-in well. And having spoken to people at the European Commission, IMF, European Central Bank, Fed, many of those actually admit in private that they don't think bail-in is a tool on the table in system-wide crisis. So in some sense, the outcome of this paper is also quite optimistic. So I thank you very much for your attention, and I look forward to receiving questions.